Hello, hello. It's a New York City pop-up. Welcome in. Welcome in on a Tuesday. Today is Tuesday. Yes, it is Tuesday. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for being here today. What is that? The Princess Diaries? Wow. Just pulled that out of the filing cabinet in my brain. You know, us millennials. We can pull out those types of references at any given second. Today is not a normal episode of MPT. Of course, that will come on Thursday, but today we're doing a pop-off because your girl had herself a weekend in New York City, the city of lights, the city of dreams. I don't think New York is technically the city of dreams. Is that LA? I don't know. The Big Apple. The concrete jungle where dreams are made of. That's where I was. And I was doing a bunch of Bravo girly stuff. So we're going to get all up into it. I mean, I went to Carl Radke's soft launch of Soft Bar and Café. I went and saw Ariana Madix in Chicago. I was living my best life. And, you know, I've been to New York a couple different times. And I will say this is the first time that I actually felt like I could survive. You know, like I knew where I was. I knew how to get a cab. I knew how to get from point A to point B. I didn't want to be in Times Square. I feel like that's when you know. When you get to the point where you go to New York frequently enough to know that you don't want to go to Times Square, you might as well be a local. I might as well have been a local. No, don't get it twisted. That is a bit much. But I also had a little experience of hell on earth while I was there. The drama. It was dramatic. And I'm going to tell you all about it because that's what we do here. But let's start with the dramatic. We'll get that out of the way. David and I didn't think we were going to make it out of New York City, you guys. It took us 24 hours to get home. And, you know, when you spend money on a trip and you spend hotels and flights and all the things, the last thing you think is that you're going to have to drive a Nissan Rogue 9 hours home. Well, that's what happened to David and I. So I don't know if you've been to JFK Airport in New York, but it's the worst. And I'll never go back. But also at the same time, every time I have a bad experience at any airport, that's my first reaction. I'll never go back. You know, it's like, chill out, Morgan, because flights sometimes get canceled and they sometimes get delayed. But our flight was canceled literally as we were on our way back to JFK. And we're like, okay, it's fine. It's 3 o'clock. We can get on another flight. Nope, not possible. The only one available was for the next day, Sunday at 3 o'clock. And you know, when they rebook you on the original airline, Delta, they give you credit to eat. They give you credit for the hotel. You know, anything that's going to cost you out of pocket, they do that, whatever. I was like having a fit. I was having a meltdown. I was like, no, I'm going home today. We're getting a rental car. Cancel the booking for tomorrow. So that's what we did. We canceled the booking. We got an e-credit, right, immediately, because I'm like, I'm taking another trip sometime in the near future on Delta for free, even though it's technically not for free because you already paid for it. Girl math, you understand. Anyways, David and I are running all over the JFK airport, which is like 800 terminals, by the way. We get to the rental car terminal. There's about 6 different places that you can get a rental car. Slowly but surely, we're going through one by one by one. There are no rental cars, okay? None. So not only now do we not have a car to get home, we also don't have a flight to get home anymore because we took the e-credit. We took the e-credit. And I'm like huffing and puffing. Thank God that I married David because he's just so the opposite of me. He's like very calm, cool, collected, patient. He's talking to the assistant on the chat. I'm like, you need to be more aggressive. And he's like, thank you very much. And I'm like, we're not going to get home, David. We're sitting here playing patty cake with the person on the chat wasn't even in our country. You know how I know? Because they asked, what day is it where you are? What day is it where you are? David was like, I'm sorry, I don't understand the question. And they were like, what is the physical date in your current location? And we're like, oh God, we're done. we're done for. So then we had to sit there and figure out what to do. Do we just book a completely new flight? Well, I don't know if you've ever tried to fly out of New York City like same day or next day, but unless you want to fork over your left kidney or maybe your firstborn child, you're not getting out of there unless you have $1,000 to just throw out the airplane window. So I was like, at this point, this is where the tears started to come in, the frustration tears. Y'all already know. I was getting all worked up thinking I'm going to have to spend another, because keep in mind, if we leave tomorrow on a flight or Monday, we're staying in a hotel for another however many days. And y'all know how expensive New York hotels are. I'm losing it. And I'm like, okay, now our only options are to fly out on Monday. This was on Saturday, by the way. Monday. Or stay overnight somewhere. Try to book a car first thing in the morning. That's what we did. We booked a car for first thing Sunday morning, 6 a.m. We're there, right? The only hotel that was available was a two-star hotel for $600. I mean, I know that New York City is expensive, but I mean, the hotel that we stayed at was in Tribeca. It was a nice area. It was a nice hotel. That was $300 a night, $600 to stay at a two-star hotel for one night. One night. It looked like it was built in 1706. And that's what we had to do. We stayed at that hotel. We got Taco Bell, Uber Eats. We got on that in that car. But the next morning, thankfully, the two-star hotel had a shuttle service that took us from the hotel to the airport free of charge. Thank you, Jesus. Save me $30. But it was taking other passengers. We had a pilot in our shuttle with us. We had this lady. We had this guy. And then it was me and David in the back. Because David and I were going to the rental car terminal, we were the last ones to get dropped off, right? So everybody puts their bags in the back, whatever. We're on our way. We're like, yes, thank you, Lord. We're going to get home today. It might be 9 hours from now, but we're going to get home. We are on the way to the rental car place. Everybody else has been dropped off at American Airlines, at Delta, at Southwest, you know, all the other terminals. David gets a notification on his phone because he has an Apple AirTag in his carry-on. After everything that we had just been through within the past 24 hours, the first man to get out of the shuttle to go to American Airlines took David's bag. You can't make it up. It had been 20 minutes since we had dropped this man off at American Airlines and wished him a speedy trip to wherever he was going to. I think he was going to Paris, to be quite honest with you. And then we get this notification that that man just took David's bag, and not just his backpack, his like carry-on bag, to Paris. To Paris. So we're like, we got to go back. Hopefully this guy realizes that he has my bag, right? So another 20 minutes in the shuttle back to the first terminal to get to the American Airlines portion of the place. We get there. And I don't want to say thank God, but I do want to say thank God, because that guy was freaking out. He was running around trying to talk to every person that had a shuttle, that was near a shuttle. You could tell he was losing it because he realized that he had somebody else's bag and his bag was still on the shuttle to Enterprise. So thankfully we got the bag. We get to the rental car place. The reservation was in David's name, because I don't know how to do any of that, right? Well, they're like, David can't drive this car because he doesn't have his passport here. And I'm like, what do you mean? And he's like, well, he only has a British driver's license, so he can't drive. So you have to drive. And I'm like, whatever. Whatever. At this point, I don't care if I have to take the Flintstones car with their feet running at the bottom of it. I'm like, I don't care. I'll walk at this point. Give me a tricycle or something. I'm going home. So I signed it away. The Lord was testing my patience. I failed multiple times, but we made it home. Happy, healthy, living life, okay? And that was at the end of the trip, and there were still some more dramatic things to happen in the beginning of the trip. Anyways, let's talk first about Ariana in Chicago. My first Broadway show that I've ever been to, I don't really know what I was expecting going into it. The theater was a lot smaller than I thought. I'll say that, but I'm not like shading it in any way. I just thought it was going to be like this huge place, but I actually liked it because it was more intimate and there was not a bad seat in the house. When Ariana came out on stage as Roxy Hart and she opened her mouth, right? We're all sitting there wondering, can she sing? Can she sing? She comes out. Everyone's excited to see our girl. She starts singing. And I literally was like, what? I was like, what? You guys, she's amazing. She's phenomenal. You cannot tell the difference. I mean, I don't know these people's backstories, but I would imagine that they worked their entire life, built their entire career to make it on Broadway. And like, not saying that Ariana didn't. Obviously, we know that she went to college for musical theater, but that's not where her life path originally was, right? She was on reality TV for 10 years. You could not tell the difference between her and somebody who had been in that role for 20 plus years. Because, you know, her co-stars, a lot of them have been in that role for more than 20 years. And she was just so good. I was shook to the core. And I'm not just saying that as a Vanderpump Rules fan. I'm saying that in general. She was so good. She was funny. Her comedic timing was amazing. She was a great singer. You know, having been both to a Tom Sandoval and the Most Extra show and now Ariana on Broadway, the talent levels are just like not comparable. I'm sorry, but it is what it is. I mean, you know that on face value. One's a cover band, another one is on Broadway. But I just was sitting there so emotional thinking of all the stuff that she has gone through. Heartbreak on national television, betrayal, you know, all of these things. And had that never happened, she would not be where she is right now. And she is thriving. And when I saw her, I was like, this is what she's made to do. I was like, how do you go from something like this that I'm assuming gives her such high positivity and endorphins and whatever, and then go back to Vanderpump Rules? I don't see how she can do it. Like, I really don't know. I really don't know, especially when you consider how last season played out. I just saw her be so happy and be so good. I'm like, this is not the end of the road for her. I feel like after this, she could get a job on any Broadway show. And if that's what she really wants to do, I mean, as sad as I would be to see it, I hope she would never go back to Vanderpump Rules, right? If she had to pick one or the other, selfishly, as an Ariana fan, I still want to see her on the show. But like, I was so impressed, you guys. I was so impressed. And I know I'm biased and I know I love her and all of these other things, but she was so good. And I'm so truly, truly happy for her. Let's move on to the reason I went to New York in the first place. The soft launch of Carl Radke's Soft Bar and Cafe. So it was a friends and family event. It was not at the house in the Hamptons. A lot of people were in my DMs being like, oh my gosh, you're at the house. No, it was actually in New Jersey. So basically what happened, got the RSVP, friends and family events. If you're staying in New York City, we'll have this transportation for you. So they picked us up on a bus. We drove a long time to get to it, but it was beautiful. And basically it was a taste test of what could be offered at Soft Bar. The physical location isn't going to be ready until 2025. So I think in the meantime, they're doing some pop-up events. But this was really like a preliminary, we're trying to get our menu down. We want you to try all of these drinks. We want your feedback. Tell us what you think. Tell us what you think of the experience. So I'm going to read some of the questions that I got from you guys and answer them. So we'll start with who was there. Well, obviously from the people that we know, Carl, Paige, Jesse, West, Gabby, Sierra, and then some newbies were there. The people that were not there were Kyle and Amanda. They were at a wedding in Italy, and Lindsay was not there, which I don't think any of us thought that Lindsay would go to that. The next question was, how did you snag an invite? Good question. So here's what I think. I mean, I can't be for certain. I just got the email and said RSVP and whatever. But having been there, I noticed that a lot of people were sober influencers. And I don't consider myself a sober influencer, but a lot of you know that my husband, David, is 5 years sober, and I'm not a huge drinker. And when we went to BravoCon, I had met Carl on a couple of different occasions and always had really good interactions with him. But there was one particular instance. He was promoting a Lover Boy event in Cleveland, and David and I went. And David at the time said, hey, I'm really proud of you. Like, as somebody else who is sober, it's really inspiring to see your journey play out on TV. So that was kind of like the first bonding moment. So then we get to last year's BravoCon, and that was before the NA Lover Boy was announced. But it was BravoCon weekend when they announced it. So obviously, David and I were super excited for a non-alcoholic version of Loverboy, because as people who aren't drinkers really, you just feel excluded. You know, like, I want to support and I want to be like in the Loverboy gang and wear the merch and like have the drinks. But if you don't drink, like, what do you do? So in that moment, I was like, oh, this is really cool, because we are now able to be included in something that I want to support Kyle and Carl and Amanda in. So I had messaged Carl at BravoCon and just said, hey, hope you have a great weekend. And he was like, I have something for you and David. So we ran into him in the VIP room. There were Bravo Labs in and out of the room pretty much the whole entire time. So we ran into Carl, and he pulls out a can of the non-alcoholic Lover Boy from his back pocket. And he said, this is for you guys. Nobody's tried this yet. You guys are going to be the first. And I thought that was really, really cool of Carl to remember us, remember David and his sobriety journey, and be mindful enough to seek us out and give us the first taste of it. And I love it. I love the non-alc. And we even went to like the Lover Boy booth after that. And we were like, oh, we just tried the non-alc and it was so great. And they were like, what? How did you we haven't even had it yet. Like, how did you guys get it? So I thought that that was really cool. So when we got there, I noticed that there was a lot of other sober influencers, I guess you could say. Like, there was one girl there. She runs an Instagram account called Sober in the City. So I really just think that he remembered that about us. And I think when you couple the fact that I'm a reality TV and pop culture correspondent, and my husband's sober, and we've always been really supportive of Carl in that journey, I think he wanted to invite us. And it was really, I'm like so grateful that he did. I mean, those types of opportunities definitely don't come up every day. So the next question, did you chat with any of the cast? I did. I said hello to everyone. I probably talked the most to Carl, obviously, because we were super grateful that he gave us an invite. I talked to Paige about her cat, Daphne. Have you seen her cat, Daphne? It's unbelievably adorable. It's like the prettiest cat in the world. It's like, of course, the prettiest cat in the world is like Paige DeSorbo's cat. Like, it only makes sense. And I just told her that I was really proud of her and Hannah, which I am. I feel like, you know, women in the arts, I feel like I look up to them. I do. I'm not afraid to admit that. I see them and I see what they've taken and how they've grown it to. And even though it might not be exactly what I do take inspiration from women like that. So I let her know that. Who else? Gabby. I talked to Gabby about this girl being there in the same dress as me. You know, I had the whole poll, blue dress or pink dress. Everyone said the blue dress. I just felt more myself in the pink dress personally. It was more my personality or whatever. And somebody did DM me and say, Morgan, every time you do a poll, you will do the opposite of what the poll tells you to do. And I'm like, yeah, you know, rebel without a cause. Listen to your heart. Do what you want to do. I guess that's what I did. But I get on the bus and I sit down, and literally the girl right next to me is in the same exact dress in green. Same exact dress. Her name is Brett. She's a sweetheart. Her and her boyfriend, Brandon, love them. The good news, I wasn't mad about it either. You know why? Because they didn't really look that much the same, unless you're like standing right next to each other. But, you know, what are you going to do? We both have good taste in dresses. So anyways, why wasn't Kyle and Amanda there? I just said because they were in Italy. Did Lindsay go? No, she did not go. Did you see Lindsay? I did not see Lindsay. And there is a story behind that that I can't tell on this podcast, but you can hear it. Patreon.com/Morgan's Pop Talks. Did Sierra and West interact while you were there? They did not. Were the drinks any good? I really liked some of them. I really disliked some of them. But I think that goes for any drink, right? Sometimes you like super fruity stuff and you don't like bitter stuff. And my husband liked all of the bitter stuff. So I think it just depends on your personal preferences. So my review of Soft Bar and Cafe, what did I think of it? I enjoyed my experience. Obviously, anybody in my shoes would enjoy that experience. I've seen negativity surrounding the launch. You know, people saying, oh, it's a horrible idea. You're paying a premium for, you know, punch or whatever. But what people don't realize is going out with your friends and you don't drink and you sit down and you say, do you have any NA beer? And they say no. Or they say, do you have any non-alcoholic thing? And they say no. It's super isolating. And the people around you might not notice it because they're all drinking and you're the only one not, but you immediately feel isolated and uncomfortable. And it's not fun. And I personally, if I'm going out to a restaurant, I still want to have a nice drink in a cute glass that looks nice and that tastes good. You know, because I see people are like, just order iced tea. Like, why are you going to pay $7 for like a fancy drink when you can just get a Coke or whatever? I don't want a Coke. It's about the experience. If I'm paying to go to a restaurant and I want to pay $7 to have a mocktail that looks cute, I'm going to do it. And I'm going to enjoy myself while I do it. I also just feel like sobriety is such a bonding thing in people's lives. And I feel like, you know, when you're the only one, like I said, it is just really isolating. So being able to go to a place, and it's not just for sober people, right? Like, let's just say that you and your group of girls want a night off of drinking. Like, you can still go there and have a good experience and take cute photos and have a good time without waking up hungover the next day. So like, I get it. And my husband, who is sober, gets it. But I feel like a lot of people that do drink and do drink a lot, they don't necessarily get it. You know, they even had mushroom-based coffee. It doesn't have any caffeine in it, and it's not decaf. But, you know, Carl was saying, I'm really sensitive to caffeine, which so is my husband. He's so sensitive to caffeine. And it's like, if he has 1.5 cups of coffee, he's up all night, and then it ruins the rest of his week. So you can go to a place like this, still enjoy something that tastes exactly like coffee, has its own little twist on it, and have different benefits of it that don't, you know, trigger you, whatever it is that triggers you on the inside, like being super sensitive to it or whatever. I think there is a space for it. And I think people need to stop being so negative about it. Like, give it a chance, let it breathe. I think New York is expensive. I mean, that's the first thing that worries me about it. And I'm not, I don't have a business like that. So I can't tell you like, oh, you need this positive cash flow to be able to pay rent and pay employees and all of these things. But like, give it a chance. People are being so rude about it before it even gets off the ground. But I mean, that's pretty much everybody, right? I also think that when you have a celebrity status, people will come to your establishment no matter what. I mean, look at Schwartz and Sandy's. Had the incident not happened, I feel like it would be a lot more popular than it is, but I still think it's popular. I think if you like Bravo and you like watching these shows and you know that Carl Radke is always at Soft Bar and Cafe, you're going to go see if you can see him. If you know Katie and Ariana are going to be at Something About Her, you're going to go see them. So I do feel like it gives a little leg up as far as that is concerned. So yeah, I mean, overall, I had a really, really good time. There's some other stuff that I have for you, some more behind the scenes stuff, like what Carl said to me about the name Soft Bar and Cafe, about maybe some new faces that were lurking around, but I'm scared to say them publicly because, like, you know, I can't even say, you know why. You know why people can't say things when it comes to this type of stuff. Legal. Someone get legal on the phone. Okay. But anyways, thank you for tuning into the pop-off. If you want to hear more about my weekend in New York City, patreon.com/Morgan's Pop Talks. If you want to get this lovely Love You Like a Sis merch that I'm rocking, morganptalks.com. You can see it all there. I'll see you back on Thursday for another episode of MPT. Love you like a sis.